Welcome back to the class, and we are continuing with the essay by Arjuna Paduri, and today's class is a continuation from the previous session. We are discussing his essay, Disjuncture and Difference in the Global Cultural Economy, and as I mentioned in the previous class, Paduri is considered to be one of the foremost anthropologists of globalization, and that too a scholar from India. So we mentioned in detail about his background, his overall contributions. So let us get into the remaining part of this essay without spending much time. So this is an essay titled Disjuncture and Difference, and it's taken from this book Modernity at Large, which was published in 1996. And I will not be discussing each and every part of this essay, a slightly lengthy, around 27-page long essay. Rather, I will be highlighting only some of the core arguments, the most important arguments. So in the previous class, we saw that how he provides a very interesting introduction to this essay, and then disagrees with some of the almost every major theorizations on cultural globalization. He disagrees with this argument of Americanization. He disagrees with the world system theory. He disagrees with quite a lot of neo-Marxian arguments about the relationship between culture and capital, and then he comes up with his own original ideas. Okay, that's where we stopped in the previous class. He is introducing these five themes. Okay, I propose that an elementary framework of exploring such disjunctures is to look at the relationship among five dimensions of global cultural flows that can be termed ethnoscape, mediascape, technoscape, financescape, and ideascape. And he says that these terms with the common suffix scape is also indicate that these are not objectively given relations that look the same from every angle of vision, but rather they are deeply perspectival constructs inflected by the historical, linguistic, and political situatedness of different sort of actors. It's a very complex sentence, but it's very important. See, when you talk about a landscape, okay, from it's the term for the landscape from where he has taken this. So when you look at landscape, what does it mean? Landscape, you understand it as a large expanse of land in front of you, okay, and that it just sprawls in front of you. You can't see the other end of that. It's a huge expanse of land unfolding in front of you. And this landscape gets different forms, or landscape offers you different views depending upon your position. Okay, if you move to some other place, it gives you a different view. If you move to some other place, it gives you a different view. So he, Paduri, is using that kind of an argument. He argues these terms with the common suffix scapes are also indicated that they are not objectively given relations that look the same from every angle of vision. They are not objective, rather they are deeply perspectival constructs. Okay, they are deeply perspectival constructs. They are kind of a constructs emerging from different perspectives, inflected by historical, linguistic, and political situatedness of different sorts of factors. Okay, so these perspectival constructs are constructed by agents who are inflected by historical, sociological, geographical, and other kind of features. And who are these actors? These actors are nation states, multinationals, diasporic communities, as well as subnational groups, groupings, and movements, whether religious, political, or economic, and even intimate face-to-face groups such as villages, neighborhoods, and families. Okay, so you can imagine the kind of complexity that he brings in this entire theorization. Okay, indeed, the individual actor is the last locus in this perspectival set of landscape. For these landscapes are eventually navigated by agents who both experience and constitute larger formations, in part from their own sense of what these landscapes offer. Okay, these landscapes thus are the building blocks of what extending Benedict Anderson's I would like to call imagined worlds. That is, the multiple worlds that are constituted by historically situated imaginations of persons and groups spread across the globe. Now, he then elaborates what does this ethnoscape means. So ethnoscape in simple sense, it's a term that indicates about the people. Okay, ethno is about people. Ethnoscape means the landscape of persons who constitute the shifting world in which we live. Okay, not the native people who live in a particular geographic area. It's not that, but rather it is the shifting, changing flow of people. Tourists, immigrants, refugees, exiles, guest workers, and others, moving groups and individuals constitute an essential feature of the world and appear to affect the politics of and between nations to a hitherto unprecedented degree. So one of his components, ethnoscape, is about the people whom you see as moving around, and that includes all these categories. And we know that the movement of people is at a heightened phase in our contemporary era compared to any other periods. Second is the technoscape. I mean the global configuration, ever so fluid, of technology, and the fact that technology, both high and low, both mechanical and informational, now moves at high speeds across various kinds of previously impervious boundaries. Okay, I don't think that we need to re-emphasize this whole point, how technology has changed the globe. How technology, in the form of informationalism, in the form of internet, in the form of now artificial intelligence, machine learning, World Wide Web, and a host of new, you know, changes are completely transforming our social world. So he is using the term technoscape to elaborate that. And then he talks about this. It is useful to speak as well as of financescapes, as the disposition of global capital is now a more mysterious, rapid, and difficult landscape to follow than ever before. Okay. Now, from where does capital flow happen? What is the origin? What is the direction? Where is it leading to? These are all become extremely difficult calculations. As currency markets, national stock exchanges, and commodity speculations move mega monies through national turnstiles at blinding speed, with vast absolute implications for smaller differences in percentage points and time units. But the critical point is that the global relationship among ethnoscape, technoscape, and financescape is deeply disjunctive and profoundly unpredictable, because each of these landscapes is subjected to its own constraints and incentives. So his argument is that the kind of ethnoscape, technoscape, and financescape, their relationship is deeply disjunctive. Okay, they are not one and the same. You will not find group of people and the technology and finance all coming together, and then it deeply being, you know, sitting together or it existing together. Okay, they are deeply disjunctive. They are deeply separated. Okay, and profoundly unpredictable, because each of these landscapes is subjected to its own constraints and incentives, and some political, some informational, some techno-environmental. At the same time, as each acts as a constraint and parameter for movements for others. So, further refracting these disjunctures, which hardly form a simple mechanical global infrastructure case, are what I call mediascapes. Okay, and ideascapes, which are closely related to landscape of images. Mediascapes refers to both to the distribution of the electronic capabilities to produce and disseminate information, newspapers, magazines, television stations, and film production studios, which are now available to a growing number of private and public interests throughout the world, and to the images of the world created by this media. Now imagine, he is not mentioning about internet, he is not mentioning about Facebook, he is not mentioning about social media, because this essay was written before these things became the kind of a buzzwords. And then imagine how Appadure's prediction has come to, you know, effect in the contemporary field. So he's talking about the capabilities of this media to produce and disseminate information. Okay, and I don't need to explain that social media has a completely different, it has provided a completely different set of meanings to these arguments. Okay, compared to the more traditional, conventional meaning, media, what does social media do to the people? Okay, and the relationship between larger multinational companies, corporations, and with that of this new social media, and the corporate connection behind it, the corporate interest behind it. Okay, the whole debate discussions about the post-truth world. Okay, the whole debate about misinformation, about false news, about fake news. Yeah, fake news is the most important one. There are accusations about, Facebook involving directly or Facebook being manipulated in the American elections. So we are living in a completely different world. And Apadre was quite insightful in talking about that. Okay, so talking about the importance of mediascape plays a very important role in this projection of imaginations. Okay, mediascape, whether produced by private or state interest, tend to be image-centered, narrative-based accounts or strips of reality. And what they offer to those who experience and transform them is a series of elements such as characters, plots and textual forms out of which scripts can be formed into imagined lives, their own as well as of others living in other places. So talking about the way in which these images are kept. And finally, the ideascapes are also concatenations of images, but they are often directly political and frequently have to do with the ideologies of the state and the counter ideologies of movements explicitly oriented to capturing state power or a piece of that. So he's talking about the power of ideologies. Okay, why certain ideologies have become so powerful? Why these ideologies have been part of the state narratives, and why certain other ideologies have become the part of the ordinary people or counter movements which are fighting against the power of the state. These ideoscapes are composed of elements of the Enlightenment worldview, which consists of a chain of ideas, terms and images, including freedom, welfare, rights, sovereignty, representation and master term democracy. Okay. And you know, these are the terms that have become kind of institutionalized, more entrenched, because they emerge in the European Enlightenment context and then later kind of spread across the globe. So it's very interesting to see how these terms, democratic terms, these liberal Enlightenment terms have been appropriated, have been used by different sections of people. So he has very interesting discussions on that. Maybe you could read that, explaining again how these ideas get transformed, how these many of these ideas get misused or disused in different contexts, how different powerful groups manipulate them. So none of these terms or none of these ideas exist in vacuum. None of these ideas exist as ideal types which can be seen in other places. So it's a very, very fascinating argument that he comes up with. Quite a lot of examples, illustrations from across the globe. So now, for example, this democracy has become a master term with powerful echoes from Haiti and Poland to the former Soviet Union and China. But it sits at the center of a variety of ideascapes composed of distinctive pragmatic configurations of rough translations of other central terms such as vocabulary of the Enlightenment. And you know, what does democracy mean in a country like China? What does democracy mean in different contexts? What does democracy mean in India is very different from what does democracy mean in other countries. So he's talking about those kind of differences. Now, the most important theorization, the central theme of his argument, okay, if somebody asks you what is the central theme of Apadure's argument about disjuncture and difference, this is it. He mentions it clearly. He argues that this extended terminological discussion of the five terms I have coined sets the basis of a tentative formulation about the conditions under which current global flows occur. Okay, so he, his way of theorization, he spoke about five different scapes, okay, ethnoscape, technoscape, financescape, mediascape and ideascape, okay, and he qualified it. What does he mean by this term scape, and how complex that term itself, their perspectival constructs, okay, of individuals, states, powerful groups, social actions, which are inflicted by a host of historical, political, social, cultural and geographic factors. Okay, and he argues this a tentative formulation about the conditions under which current global flows occur. So he is going to define, okay, how does cultural current global flow happens? Okay, what is a kind of a current cultural global flow happens? what kind of transformation happening in the contemporary globalized society? They occur in and through the growing disjunctures among ethnoscape, technoscape, financescape, mediascape, and ideascape. So he argues that the current global flows, okay, of whether it is of money, of people, of ideas, anything, they happen through in growing disjunctures among these things. Okay, these things are not one and the same. There is increasing difference, there is increasing separation, there is increasing disjunctures between these five things. This formulation, the core of my model of global cultural flows, needs some explanation. First, people, machinery, money, images, and ideas now follow increasingly non-isomorphic paths. Okay, they don't go together alone. Okay, you will not see that all of them sitting together, all of them existing together. Of course, all periods of human history, there have been some disjunctures in the flows of things, but the sheer speed, scale, and volume of each of these flows are now so great that the disjunctures have become central to the politics of global culture. Okay, so this differences through which the cultural flows happen is happening through a kind of an increasing disjuncture between these five important scapes that define the contemporary global scenario. Okay, so he gives examples, and he talks about, for example, he gives an example of this deterritorialization. Okay, deterritorialization in general is one of the central forces of the modern world because it brings laboring population into lower class sectors and spaces relatively wealthy societies, while sometimes creating exaggerated and intensified sense of criticisms or attachment to the politics in the home state. Deterritorialization, whether Hindus, Sikhs, Palestinians or Ukrainians, is now at the core of the variety of global fundamentalism, including Islamic and Hindu fundamentalism. So what does he mean to be deterritorialized? Look at the case of diasporic communities. Okay, communities, for example, Indian diaspora in the Europe or Indian diaspora in the US. These are the people who were born and brought up in India, but those who decide to live somewhere else. Okay, so there is a substantial section of Indian population there in the US. And they are, according to Apaduri and others, they have a deterritorialized sense of Indian identity. They are Indians, but they live somewhere else. And then for them, Indian tradition is something that they will have to really recreate very, very consciously out there. And that can take very, very different forms. For example, he says that in the Hindu case, for example, it is clear that the overseas movement of Indians have been exploited by a variety of interests, both within and outside India, to create a complicated network of finances and religious identification, by which the problem of cultural reproduction of Hindus abroad has become tied to the politics of Hindu fundamentalism at home. Okay, there are quite a lot of Hindu organizations in the US who support the rise of Hindu nationalism back in India because they see it as a part of their political activities. So he says that it is in the fertile ground of deterritorialization, in which money, commodities and persons are involved in ceaselessly chasing each other around the world, that the mediascapes and ideoscapes of the modern world find their fractured and fragmented counterpart. Okay? For the ideas and images produced by mass media often are partially guided to the goods and experiences that deterritorialized population transfer to one another. So he's talking about the constant flow of people and how this constant flow of people also accompanies the flow of different ideas, different images, different media and a host of other things. He gives an example of Meera Nair's film Indian Cabaret. He gives the example of Gulf returnees in Kerala. They're bringing cabaret cassettes or soft pornography cassettes. So a whole lot of illustrations and examples are given in this section. So please read that. So while far more could be said about the cultural politics of deterritorialization and the larger sociological displacement that it expresses, it is appropriate at this juncture to bring in the role of the nation state in the disjunctive global economy of culture today. So what does the global state do in this kind of a scenario, okay, where people are moving across the globe, a lot of people are coming and then settling down in your place, a lot of your own population are living in somewhere else, and imagine the case of European societies, okay, the contemporary, for example, the case of Germany. So Germany has quite a lot of refugee population. Germany has quite a lot of asylum seekers. Germany has quite a lot of people from countries like India or Pakistan who have come there as skilled laborers. So a country like Germany or most of the Western European countries are forced to deal with a lot of population from other places. Britain is an excellent example in that sense. The relationship between states and nations is everywhere an embattled one. And this is a very, very interesting point that he's talking about. It is possible to say that in many societies, the nation and the state have become one another's project. So what does it mean? That is, while nations, or more properly groups with the idea about nationhood, seek to capture or co-opt state and state power, states simultaneously seek to capture and monopolize ideas about nationhood. So he's talking about the kind of a tension between the state and the nation. You know, usually we talk about the nation as the people who belonging to a particular a geographic area, and we think that the state has a complete authority over the people. So that is why you use this term nation state, either as a single term or with a hyphen, indicating that they are one and the same. Okay, the people who belong to a particular territory, they identify themselves with the state. But it's not the case. Okay, different sections of people, different groups of people will have different ideas about their nationality. Okay, so they will not agree with the state power. So that is why quite a lot of secessionist groups emerge across the globe. We had serious cases of Tamil secessionism in Sri Lanka. In India, we had Khalistan movement. We had secessionist movements in the northeast. In Kashmir, we still have. So these ideas are really put forward, this important tension between the idea of a nation as celebrated, as harbored by a small section of population, and that of the state power. So the state tries to capture or co-opt, for example, the nation, or more properly, groups with ideas about nationhood seek to capture or co-opt states and state power. State simultaneously seeks to capture and monopolize ideas about the nationhood. Okay, in general, he gives the quite a lot of examples about the separatist national movements. So hence, here national and international mediascapes are exploited by nation states to pacify separatist or even potential fissiparousness of all ideas of difference. And he invites your attention to the ways in which nation states utilizes, manipulates the media, okay, to talk about the kind of a singular nationalist idea. One important new feature of global culture politics, tied to the disjunctive relationship among the various landscapes discussed earlier, is the state and the nation are at each other's throats, and the hyphen that link them is now less an icon of conjuncture than an index of disjuncture. Okay, so he's saying that the political power as represented by the state and the aspirations of the people as represented by the nation need not go together. Okay, so they are at each other's throat. This disjunctive relationship between the nation and state has two levels. At the level of any given nation state, it means that there is a battle of imagination with the state and nation seeking to cannibalize one another. Here is the seedbed of brutal separatism, majoritarianism that seemed to have appeared from nowhere, and micro incidences that have become political projects within nation states. At another level, this disjunctive relationship is deeply entangled with the global disjuncture discussed throughout this chapter. Ideas of nationhood appear to be steadily increasing in scale and regularly crossing existing state boundaries, sometimes as with coups, because previous identities stretched across vast national spaces, or with the Tamils in Sri Lanka, the dormant threats of a transnational diaspora have been activated to ignite micropolitics of a nation state. So he is looking at this tension at two levels. One, within the geographical region of the nation, where mostly it takes the form of a majoritarianism, okay, where the majority of the people who live in that particular country want to define it after them. They want a national culture. For example, if the case of India, you can say that there is one kind of an argument that Indian culture must be defined on the basis of the dominant religion. Or there is similar arguments in Germany, similar arguments in America, or in Poland, or in different countries, that their national culture needs to be defined on the basis of the dominant majority communities. Okay, so that is one type of this kind of a struggle or tussle that is going on. The other one, he says that these diaspora communities provide the spread of such kind of an imagination. For example, the Tamil Eelam movement in Sri Lanka was heavily benefited by the diasporic Tamils in for example in Canada or in other places, or in who lived in the UK or in Germany or other places. Yeah, so there are quite a lot of illustrations and examples. You can go through that. Okay. Returning then to the ethnoscape which I began, the central paradox of ethnic politics in today's world is that primordia. Okay, primordia means it's your primordial affinities, the things that you are born into, your caste, your religion, your ethnic identity and your nationality and other stuff. Primordia, whether of language or skin color or neighborhood or kinship, have become globalized. That is, sentiments whose greatest force is in their ability to ignite intimacy into a political state and turn locality into a stage ground for identity have become spread over vast and irregular spaces as groups move yet stay linked to each another through sophisticated media capabilities. This is a central theme of his argument, and not only his argument, that of the cultural understanding of globalization. Okay, the primordia, the very strong sense of affinity that we feel towards our own people. Okay, so what does it mean to be our own people? Our own people with whom we share this kind of an ethnic identity. Okay, our skin color, our language, our caste, our religion, our ethnicity, our tribe. And these people, if once they used to historically they used to live in a given geographic area, and then that used to be quite fine because they constitute a community, they live together. Now they have spread across the globe, and yet from these different localities of the globe they are able to connect with each other with the help of this media and then communication facilities, and they reignite different kind of passion, they reignite different kind of imagination, and these imaginations as social practices are extremely potent according to Appadure. Okay, so then he brings in the relationship between cultural and economic levels of this new set of global dissenters is not a simple one. What is the relationship between the kind of a cultural and economic level? It's not a one-way street in which the terms of global cultural politics are set wholly or confined wholly within the vicissitudes of international flow of technology, labor and finance, demanding only a modest modification of existing neo-Marxist models of uneven development of state information. So where does the kind of a tension between culture and economy come from? Okay, is it that the economy completely decides everything and then the culture has to adjust with that? No. Here he says that there's a deeper change itself driven by the disjunctures among all the landscapes I have discussed and constructed by their continuously fluid and uncertain interplay that concerns the relationship between production and consumption in today's global economy. So he has some very interesting arguments about the whole idea of a production and consumption. He says that here I begin with Marx's famous and often maligned view of fetishism of a commodity, and suggest that this fetishism has been replaced in the world at large. Now seeing the world as one large interactive system composed of many complex systems by the two mutually supportive descendants, the first of which I call the production fetishism and the second fetishism of the consumers. I hope that you have some familiarity with Marxian idea about a fetishism of a commodity. So Marx argued that in the capitalist era, a commodity very efficiently masks the human labor involved in it. Okay, and it efficiently masks the human labor involved in it, and it becomes a fetish. Okay, for example, some of this high brand value stuff, high things that the brand value something so high. So things are not used for its utilitarian purpose. Things are not used or valued for their utility. Rather, it becomes a fetish. Certain brands become a fetish. Okay, certain items, certain consumer items become a fetish. So once things become a fetish, it really prevents, or it really masks the kind of real economic relations behind its production. That's the kind of a Marxian argument about the fetishism of commodities. Now, Appaduri is arguing that that is not the predominant tendency now. Of course, it exists, but more important is the fetishism of production and fetishism of the consumer itself. So what does he mean by that? By production fetishism, I mean an illusion created by contemporary transnational production loci that mask translocal capital, transnational earning flows, global management, and often faraway workers engaged in various kinds of high-tech putting out operations in idiom and spectacle of local, sometimes even worker-controlled national productivity and territorial sovereignty. So he's saying that in a globalized form of production, this whole production has become so difficult to discern, so difficult to disentangle. Okay, for example, any product that comes to you, whether it is it's mentioned it's made in China or made in India, most of the time we get to see things, electronic stuff made in China. So what does it mean, made in China? Does it mean that it is completely made by the people of China in China? Okay, or is it made by a company owned by Chinese? Where does this capital flow come from? What is the role of Indian companies in importing them? Okay, who are the people who actually worked there? So these are things completely opaque. Okay, it doesn't make it's absolutely difficult for us to discern that. What is the kind of a network of production, whether a company like an iconic company like Apple, okay, their most important manufacturing hub is in China. So how does an American iconic company like Apple, what is the kind of a production process involved in? So similarly, he argues that these modern forms of capitalism completely makes this production process completely opaque. Okay, it's not like the earlier place where you see a company where owned by a family or by a man, and he is a bourgeoisie and he has all the workers, and a particular product is completely produced there from the scratch. That is completely disappeared. We are in a completely extremely complicated form of production. And he says, but to the extent that various kinds of free trade zones have become the modes of production at large, especially high-tech commodities, production has itself become a fetish, obscuring the social relations as such, but the relations of production, which are increasingly transnational. The relations of production between the people who own the means of production and the people who do not own. The locality, both in the sense of the local factory or site of production and in the extended sense of nation states, becomes a fetish that disguises the globally dispersed forces that actually drive the production process. So he's saying that there is a production fetishism. Okay, it generates alienation in Marxian sense, which are twice intensified, for its social sense is now compounded by a complicated spatial dynamic that is increasingly global. We know that many of our people, many of our relatives or friends who are working in companies, they may not even know what they are producing. Okay, they may not even know for whom they are producing. It becomes a completely different scenario now. Then as for fetishism of the consumer, I mean to indicate here that the consumer has been transformed through the random, through commodity flows and the mediascape, especially the advertising that accompany them, into a sign, both in Baudrillard's sense of simulacrum, that only symptomatically approaches the form of a real social agent, and in the sense of a mask for the real seat of agency, which is not the consumer but the producer and the many forces that constitute process. So he is talking about Baudrillard's sense of simulacrum, that we are he's talking about the hyper realities. We are always in a sense of simulacrum. The argument is that the advertisements provide you with a sense of empowerment. Okay, advertisement is asking you to choose from the wider options that are available. Advertisements tell you that the consumer is the king. Consumer has the ability to choose from whatever the available options. But ultimately, the consumer is not the chooser. consumer, the options are already laid out. Your needs are already laid out. Okay, your demands are already laid out by the corporates, and the advertisement is only to lure you, only to attract you to into this available spaces, and then asking you to choose whatever is required for you. So the globalization of culture is not the same as homogenization, but globalization involves the use of variety of instruments of homogenization: armaments, advertising techniques, language, hegemonies, and clothing styles that are absorbed into local political cultural economies, only to be repatriated as heterogeneous dialogues of national sovereignty, free enterprise, fundamentalisms in which state plays an increasingly delicate role. Too much openness to global flows and the nation state is threatened by revolt. Okay, too much openness to global flows, then the nation state is threatened by revolt, because you are welcoming too much of radical ideas and people and other things, as in the China syndrome. Too little and the state exits the international stage, as in Burma, Albania, North Korea, in various ways have done. So you have to really strike a balance about the opening up of your borders. Okay, you can't survive without opening up of your borders, because you require international capital. Okay, and if you open too much, then quite a lot of powerful ideas, cultures, various stuffs will come and then blow you away. If you shut yourself completely, you will be outside this whole global flow. So that is the kind of argument that he puts forward. In general, the state has become the arbitrator of this repatriation of difference. Okay, the form of goods, signs, slogans, and styles. But this repatriation or export of the designs of commodities of differences continuously exacerbate the internal politics of majoritarianism and homogenization, which is most frequently played out in debates over heritage. So this we will take up later when you talk about this majoritarianism. As I mentioned in this his work, this fear of small numbers, we will take up that particular idea. So the center feature of global culture today is the politics of the mutual effort of sameness and difference to cannibalize one another and thereby proclaim the successful hijacking of the twin enlightenment ideas of the triumphantly universal and the resiliently particular. Its brighter side is in the expansion of many individual horizons of hope and fantasy, in the global spread of oral rehydration therapy and other lower tech instruments of well-being, in the susceptibility even of South Africa to the force of global opinion — he is talking about the abolition of apartheid — in the inability of the Polish state to repress its own working class, and the growth of a wide range of progressive transnational alliances. So there are one more section which I am not discussing, the work of reproduction in an age of mechanical art. I am not discussing, there are one or two more sections, but this is his core argument when he talks about the disjuncture and difference in the global cultural economy. And I hope you must have understood that Appaduri is presenting a far more complicated — I can't really sufficiently emphasize enough the kind of complexity that he brings in this single essay. Okay, the kind of multiple perspectives that he brings in, the kind of number of actors and the role of contingency that he brings in. It's a brilliant essay. That is why it's one of the most cited, one of the most read essays on cultural globalization that you from an Indian scholar. Okay, so let us stop here, and I would strongly urge you to read this essay completely, maybe a couple of times, so that you understand it it well. Okay, so we will meet again in the next session with again we'll have to we will discuss Appaduri's remaining important arguments, especially the production of locality. We will discuss that in the coming class. Okay, so thank you. We'll stop here.